Welcome to God First. I'm Bishop Patrick L. Wooden, Sr., pastor of the Upper Room Church of God in Christ, Raleigh, North Carolina, and I have a message for you today. Hey, I'm in the sanctuary where everything happens, and I want to invite you to come and worship with us here at the Upper Room Church of God in Christ. Now, today's message is entitled, A Native Witness. Hear as the word is preached concerning how Jesus met the man monster of Gadara, the maniac of Gadara, a man who cursed the Lord and blessed the Lord at the same time. But when Jesus was finished with this man was a mighty witness for Christ. Listen to what Jesus does to this man.
We have in our text a story of great deliverance. We have in our text also a beautiful story, this story of great deliverance, but it is a story that is also filled with contrast. We have a story that contains an answer that Jesus gave, or a response that our Lord gave only once during his entire earthly ministry. We have a great story that teaches us how to respond when the answer we seek in life or from God is not the answer that is given. Oftentimes, what we expect to hear is not what we hear. The answer we receive, we seek, is not always the answer that is given. Lastly, we have a story that emphasizes the need, the necessity of a native witness. By native, I mean an indigenous person, an aboriginal person. The Australians refer to the native Australians as Aborigine, indigenous people. Simply put, people from the same origin or from the same place. Native. I am a native North Carolinian. North Carolina is my home state. Praise the Lord. Transplant in the city of Raleigh, but I am a southern boy, southern born and southern bred through and through. I am a native of the South. I'm not an Indian, but technically I am a Native American. So technically you're an African American. No, I may be an American of African descent, but I was not born on the continent of Africa. I was born on the continent of the United States of America. I am a native of this country. I am a native, and I am not an invader, nor am I an explorer. I am a native. Amen. Native witness. And of course, a witness is literally one who remembers or has knowledge or joint knowledge of something. So there is a need. This message will show you the need of a native witness. Natives can identify on a particular level that non-natives can't. There are all kinds of things that make people akin to others on a particular level. Man who has never been hooked on drugs can most certainly spread the gospel. Man who has been strung out can be a more effective witness to the strung out than the man who's never been through that. Person who's never drank at all can most certainly win people to the Lord who have had a substance abuse or alcohol abuse problem. But a ex-drinker can be much more effective than a person who has never been drunk or had a drink, because they are, to some degree, a can. They are native. We will talk to you about a native witness. Our text contains an amazing power. It demonstrates an amazing power of deliverance. Major, an amazing demonstration of God's power to deliver is given in the text. But before we deal with the amazing power of God's deliverance that's in our text, I want to point out to you that the amazing deliverance of the text literally is preceded by another amazing demonstration of power. Well, if you back up into chapter 4, verse 35 through 41, we see the power of Christ on display out in the Sea of Galilee on a wet, stormy night where the sea was violent. We see the power of our Lord as he quietened the storm. Allow me just for a few minutes. It had been an incredibly long day. About like my week was this week. Just a week of, it was something. Our Lord had a long day. He had worked so hard during this day that his friends literally tried to stop him because they said that he was, in their words, not mine, beside himself. If you look at chapter 3, verse 20 says, and the multitude come together again so that they could not so much as eat. The Lord and the disciples didn't have a chance to even grab a bite. And when his friends heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him, and they said, he is beside himself. And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of devils, he cast out devils. So our Lord was casting out so many devils that his friend says, he's overdoing it, and his enemy says he's operating under the power of the devil. He was healing people left and right. After taking out time to teach his friends, then his family came. But they wouldn't come into the house. Somebody told Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside. And he looked at them in verse 33 of chapter 3 and says, who is my mother? Oh, my brethren. And he looked round about on them which sat about him. He's in the house right now. And said, behold, my mother and my brethren. For whosoever do the will of God, the same is my brother and my sister and my mother. And you would think that that would end his day with all that healing and preaching and teaching that he did. He had gone about and named the disciples. I mean, he was working. Chapter 3, verse 10 says, he healed many, insomuch that they pressed upon him for to touch him. And as many as had plagues and unclean spirits, when they saw him, they fell down before him and cried, saying, Thou art the Son of God. And straightway he charged them that they should not make him known. Verse 13 says, he goeth up into a mountain and calls the disciples. And then when he goes up to the mountains, you see verse 20, the multitude follow him, and they press on him. And in chapter 4, he goes into a boat, and he begins again to teach by the seaside. And he went into a ship, according to the first verse of the fourth chapter. Everybody say, a long day. He taught them in parables, and we find him now saying to his disciples, and I told you Mark is a very detailed writer, in chapter 4, verse 35, and the same day. See, all this was the same day. Long day. Everybody say, long day. And the same day, when the evening was come, Mark even tells us what time of day it was. Finally, the sun is beginning to set. He said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent the multitude away, they took him even as he was in the ship. You remember, he preached from the ship. They took him, and there were also with him many other little ships. Now, because of the geographical, just allow me to lay this foundation, the geographical location of the Sea of Galilee, it made the Sea of Galilee especially susceptible to sudden violent storms. But at night and early in the morning, the sea would be calm. But it would be nothing for the skies to be calm and over the Sea of Galilee, and just bam, a storm would come up. Our text tells us, and there arose a great storm. You see that? Storm of wind, and the waves beat on the ship so that it was now full. The ship was swamped. The storm was so bad, and they were taking on water, and the little ship is tossed way up and dropped way low. And it's jet black. You know, most of us don't know darkness, because in our world, lights are everywhere. Street lights, headlights, night lights, you name it, there are lights. And in many cases, we don't even see the stars like we used to, for the distant city lights that put a sheen over the sky. And we don't see darkness as they did. But when you're out there on the Sea of Galilee, and the black night sky is covered with storm clouds, and it's raining, and there's no light except when the lightning would flash, and they're out there on this ship and it's taking on water, that's a frightening situation. And with all of these things going on, we find our Lord, he was in the hinder part, in the stern of the ship, asleep on a pillow. There was a little cushion there, and he took the cushion and rolled it up and made himself a pillow after such a long day of ministry, and our Lord went to sleep. He was in REM sleep. The lightning didn't wake him up. The ship, Brother Hartman, being tossed and driven didn't wake him up. Sister Tracy, nothing woke him up. God bless you, Sister Sandra. Good to see you back. Amen. Smith, we thank the Lord for you. The Lord has laid hands on you. We'll believe in God for you. He's asleep. Lightning flashing, thunder roaring. And while in REM sleep, he's approached in a totally inappropriate manner. Be careful when you get scared and get desperate. You still ought to remain appropriate. It was inappropriate for our Lord to have been spoken to and awakened from his sleep the way that he was. And had they really known who he was and who he is, they would have also known that they were not in as much danger as they appeared to be in. Because if you're in a situation and the Lord Jesus is on your side, everything can be going wrong. But if Jesus is fast asleep and he's not worried, that ought to tell you that it's already done. That something has already been taken care of. So they speak to him as he's asleep on a pillow. I'm going to preach in a moment. And the Bible says, and they awake him, not just one, several of them. They awake him, saying unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? That's inappropriate. I mean, wake up is one thing, but to accuse him of not being concerned, that's right much. Of course he cares. Carest thou not that we perish? And he arose. And what he did was, we were going to see in our text that there were two rebukes. He rebukes nature and he rebukes them. First, he rebukes the storm. He said, he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace, be still. And right then in there, nature obeyed his voice and the wind ceased. And that was a great calm. It didn't level off. The storm didn't pass. The storm died. Boom. End of that. Then, look at our text. And then he said unto them, why are you so fearful? What are you so afraid about? How is it that you have, even at this late date, I've chosen you? You've seen me heal the sick. You've seen people walk up to me and touch me and get made whole. You've seen my power on display. What are you afraid of? Why is it that even at this point, with all that you've seen, why is it that you have no faith? They'd seen enough. And I contend that we've seen enough. Not all of us, but those of us who are veterans in the Lord, we've been saved too long to panic like we panic. To be as distressed as we are. To be as nervous and depressed as we are. Oh my, been saved too long. Seen too much from God to need a tranquilizer. Bible said, and they feared exceedingly. And one said to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the waves, or the wind and the sea, obey him? All right. While trying to get a little respite, trying to get away from the work of ministry and leave the multitude to get a little break, they go to the other side. Let me say this to you. The grass always looked greener on the other side. You know, everybody longs for something else. People long for someone else's life or someone else's position or for another car or for something. We always want the other side. But one of the things our text is going to show you is whether you're on the east side of the Sea of Galilee or on the west side, there are demons on both sides. There are no sides in life that are without their challenges, without their difficulties. Amen. They went to the other side. Are you with me? And I'm going to preach in a moment. And when they came over to the other side, now they're on the eastern shore, they come to eastern shore of the Sea of Galilee, they come to the land of the Gadareans. And when he was come out of the ship, the moment he gets out the ship, away from the crowd, don't have to worry about them anymore. I got a break. The disciples saying, we can rest now. Woo! Everything's cool for a minute. Yeah. This is a good lesson. The moment he steps out, the Bible says, immediately. Sometimes there's no rest for the weary. Immediately there met him out of the tomb a man with an unclean spirit. Oh, my Lord. We've just seen nature out of control in the wind. Now we're about to see nature out of control in a man. And that were demons. You don't like my preaching today. That were devils on both sides. Amen. Remember, he cast them out. Chapter 3, verse 22. He was casting out devils on the west side, only to meet the devil on the east side. Oh, you might as well stay with your husband. You may as well stay with your wife. Because if you leave that devil on the east side, you know, see, everybody has challenges. No one or no situation is perfect. Amen. Sometimes when we try to improve ourselves, we make matters worse. So we find nature, the devil on the west side, and then the devil got in the journey to the east side, and then when they get to the east side, there's the devil again. I'm going to preach in a moment. This man, men's department, Brother Wilson, you can appreciate this. Brother Williams, this man was more monster than man because he was out of control. Devil can make you more monster than human. A pedophile is a monster. You mess with somebody's child, you more monster than humans. Something wrong with that. Amen. Look at this monster man. Bible says this about this monster man, said he had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. I told you, Mark's a detail. Right. He could have just left, no man could bind him. But he adds, not even chains that Smith could bind him. Isn't that something? Then he says this. He says, because, let me tell you why I know this. And this had to be encouraging, because when Mark wrote his book, he wrote his book to the persecuted believers at Rome. And when they received his letter, it had to encourage them when they hear about how their Lord could quieten the storm. And how their Lord, whom they were being persecuted for, could cast out devils. And how their Lord could handle things. He said, because he had often been bound with fetters and chains. Fetters lock the feet together. They restrict movement. Can't run because he's fettered. Chains and fetters. This man had been bound, and he had plucked them asunder. Fetters had been broken in pieces, chains plucked asunder, and neither could any man tame him. None of the therapy of the land could help. I'm moved by the commercials that's out about all the people talking to cancer. Well, they tell cancer, you take the weak, you take the strong, you don't discriminate, but we're going to beat you. We're going to beat you with laughter. We're going to beat you with therapy. We're going to beat you with medicines. They're not going to beat cancer with that because they leave out something. You got to put prayer. If you're going to win, somebody's got to pray. See. Otherwise, these chains and fetters, these methods won't work. Preach wouldn't. They tried to bind this maniac, this monster man, but they couldn't. And then the text says, and always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus, you know he saw Jesus before Jesus saw him. He ran over there to get a break. He didn't go over there to heal the man. He went to get a break. And I'm telling you something interesting. When he saw Jesus, you know, let me tell y'all something about Jesus. Can I tell you something about Jesus? Tom, Jesus brings out the best and the worst in a man. Jesus makes everything surface. That's why sometimes in a good Holy Ghost service, demons get cast out. Folk had the devil in them for a long time, but they just hadn't been in an anointed service where the anointing was strong enough to cause that devil to manifest. And sometimes the hardest person, because they're in a service filled with divine power, their heart breaks and they give in. We find a man whose mind was so torn by the devil that he both worshiped and cursed at the same time. That he both confessed and blasphemed at the same time. This is what the presence of Christ did. When he saw Jesus, our text says, he ran and worshiped and. He ran and worshiped him and. Do you see it? Are you with me? Ran and worshiped him and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee, that is, make a promise, make a deal with God the Father that you will not torment us. The man worshiped and cursed the Lord at the same time. The man acknowledged his lordship through worship, but said, what have I to do with you? The man blessed the Lord and blasphemed the Lord at the same time. Thank God that our Lord responded to the good in the man. Thank you, Jesus. For the Lord had said unto him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. See, when the man ran to Jesus, worshiping and blessing, Jesus said, come out of you unclean spirit. He looked past the man and saw the devil in the man and said, come out of the man. You in unclean spirit. Are you with me? And then he says something that goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 2. See, you know, when God really gave Adam power, you know when Adam really had power over the creation? It's when he gave them all names. See, when you know the name, you know the behavior. And the name, see, by mastering the name, you get authority. This is why Jesus looked at that devil and said, what is your name? Jesus, God the Father said to Adam, he brought all the animals to Adam, and he said, name them. You name them. See, the person who has the name has the power. So Jesus says to that demon spirit, what is your name. That devil said, my name is Legion, for we are many. There could have been 6,000 demons in that man. We are many. And he besought him much that he would not send him away out of the country. That is, Legion began to beg Jesus. I'm preaching good. The devil began to plead with our Lord, please don't send us out of this country. Notice how helpless the devil was. Let me tell you, devil worshipers, something. Those of you who sell your soul, those of you who worship the Baphomet, those of you who sell out to get a Hollywood role and you participate in satanic, homosexual, lesbian orgies to get a hit record or to get a movie role or to get famous or to get rich, you are serving a defeated foe. Everything is going down but the word of God. God is exalted. The devil is defeated. And Jesus is Lord. The power is still in the name of Jesus. We find these demons, the same demons that made a monster out of a man. We find these demons acting like little punks, begging Jesus, please don't send us out of the country. Please promise God the Father that you won't torment us before our time. Please, Jesus, God, we know that you're the Son of God, and we're helpless when it comes to you because you're the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I need a few folk to shout to the King here. You got to know who Jesus is. The devil don't have all the power. The Lord said, all power. In heaven and earth is given unto me. Yes, I'm saved, and saved I will stay, if for no other reason. I have many, but if for no other reason, Dorothy, there's no other place for me to go, because Wanda, Jesus has the words of eternal life. Am I right, McCoy? If I leave him, there's nowhere to go but down. If I leave him, there's no place to be but lost. I'm glad to be on the Lord's side. Could I get a few folk to shout something if you're glad to be on the Lord's side? Let me preach here. And oh my Lord. They begged him. And all the devils besought him. Notice they broke rank in the kingdom of Satan as in the kingdom of God. The leader is supposed to speak for everybody. And remember when Jesus asked him his name, he says, my name is Legion, for we are many. You see that? But now in verse 12 says, and all the devils besought him. All them demons said, wait a minute. We're in a desperate situation because we're up against somebody that we have no power. We cannot contend with him. This is the Son of God. This is the one. So all them devils began to beg Jesus, all 6,000 of them, saying, please send us to the swines. Please. And that was verse 11 said there were swines on the hill feeding. And let us enter into them. Please, please, please. 6,000 times. Please, 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 please. They're just begging him. They're begging him. They're begging him. Please, 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 please. Because if he wants to, he can send us out of this country. If he wants to, wherever he sends us, we got to go. Please. And I heard the Lord say, verse 13, Jesus, and forthwith Jesus gave them leave. He said, go. And let me tell you something. The demons already had the bags packed. Didn't nobody have to go back in and get a toothpaste or get a toothbrush? No one had to get shoes, and nobody needed a suitcase. When the Lord said, go, they boogied, man. They booked. They left that man's body. I ain't talking about tearing him or nothing. They ran out of there. So we got to leave here lest he change his mind. And went straight to the swines. And when he went into those filthy animals. I know you had your bacon this morning, but when he went into those filthy animals, the Bible teaches, amen, that they ran violently down a steep hill into the sea, and they were drowned, and there were about 2,000 of them. That's what they wanted to do to the man. But that man saw Jesus, and he made a mad dash. I wonder today, when I open the altar, will there be a man in here or a woman who don't know the Lord, who will recognize their chance and make a mad dash to Jesus Christ? So now we see here contrast. I've just mentioned the two deliverances. We've gone from rain to no rain. Gone from a man being demon possessed to a man being free. Notice the radical change described in verse 15. Verse 15 says, and when they were come to Jesus, see, because the folk who fed the swine ran and told the city about the things that happened. So the people came out to see this mighty man of God. And see him when they came to Jesus, they see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion. Was and had. Praise the Lord. You may remember what I used to be, but that's used to be. Praise the Lord. How many have a past in here? You can speak to where you once was. You once were. But then God bring you out. Found him that had the devil. And had the legion. First of all, look at the detail of Mark. They found him sitting. Can I get a witness? No longer wandering aimlessly. No longer running, breaking chains and fetters, running through the tombs, but now he's sitting at Jesus' feet. The rage is gone. The restlessness is gone. Hallelujah. That violent nature, gone. The insanity, good God Almighty, I'm getting ahead of myself, gone. They found him, number one, sitting. And number two, look at the spirit of decency that came over. We could use that spirit today. They found him clothed. Can I get a witness? No longer naked. No longer showing his body to the world. But clothed. Sitting. Clothed. And look at this one. And in his right mind. No more violence. No longer violent. Not tormented. Not crying and cutting himself. Not scaring people. But delivered. Everybody shout delivered. Thank you, Jesus. Notice the contrast of the condition he's in since he met Jesus. It took two or three verses to describe him before he met Jesus. My God, from verse 2 to verse 5. But after Jesus got through with him, verse 15, sitting, clothed, and in his right mind. Why can you find him? Is he in the graveyard? No, he's at Jesus' feet. Is he terrorizing anybody? No, he's at peace now. Is he indecent? No, he's clothed now, and he's in good shape. And notice this, and the Bible said that, and they were afraid. I wonder who exactly were the insane people. That's the wrong reaction. See, some of us give the wrong reaction to deliverance. To see the man clothed, sitting, and in his right mind, knowing how the man used to be, you shouldn't be afraid. That's where you need Sister Shirley Johnson to break out sideways with that shout. This is why we need the late Mother Breedlove to come. come up and begin to dance and praise the Lord. We need some praises. When you find somebody who used to be messed up, and then when you see them and you see where the Lord had brought them from, my God, it's rocket time. It's church house band time. It's amen corner time. We used to praise the Lord when folk got delivered. Can I get a praise in here from somebody? Praise the Lord. You ought to be able to just look at somebody and see where the Lord brought them from. And I don't know, it ought to get in your hands. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, they gave the wrong reaction. You got to know how to respond to God's goodness. You can't get afraid of it, and you can't treat it like it's nothing. But you got to get all excited and say, he brought me out and he did something wonderful in my life. Can I get a witness in here? They were afraid, and they that saw it told them how it happened and how the devil was cast out of him. And then concerning the swine, I don't know why they would even mention the swine, because the swine, 2,000 swine, was a small price to pay, because that was nothing, because a little while later, Jesus was going to give his whole life. Some of us get upset over the wrong thing, and these people talking about the swines when they should have been rejoicing. And when the folks heard about the swine, they told Jesus to leave that coast. You know what that tells me? They cared nothing for the man. That tells me that the man didn't matter to them. Because if they would have loved that man, they would have been happy that Jesus set him free. You can tell where people stand when you get blessed. Because sometimes they get funny and sometimes they get strange. But people who really love you, when they see God doing something for you, they get with it. When they see God raising you up, they treat it like it's theirs. When they see God bless your child, it's as though God blessed their child. When you love somebody and you see the glory on them, you're just as happy for them as you would be if it was for you. I wonder if there's anybody here that loved their neighbor. I wonder if there's anyone in here who see the glory of God on somebody else. I think I'll preach this morning. I wonder if there's anybody here who will praise God for his goodness, kindness, and tender mercy, not just for what he's done for you, but what he's done around you, for what he did in your friend's life, what he did in your family, what he did in your neighbor. Yeah, Lord. Yeah! Somebody give him praise in here. Oh! Bring me up, Rick. And notice what they did. They began to beg Jesus. They didn't beg him for more of the same. They didn't beg him to stay and heal. On the west side, they brought people to him. But on this east side, in the land of these Gentiles, they were Gentiles, and what they saw was this Jew. I'm headed for my text here. They saw this Jew come in and mess up their swines. They knew the Jews didn't care anything for pigs, and this Jew then messed up our living. 2,000 swines are in the water and they are drowned. This Jew should have delivered the man, but saved our pigs. And they said to him, because you don't understand us, leave us. They begged him to leave. Jesus didn't want to leave, but they begged him to leave. And we find Jesus getting on the ship, getting ready to leave. And while he was getting ready to go, I hear a voice in the distance saying, Jesus, take me with you. Jesus, don't leave me here. These people don't care about me. You saved me. You loved me. You delivered me. Lord. Lord, let me go with you. Oh, Lord, take me, take me. Jesus looked at the man. Everybody else who wanted to go, he took them. Told Zacchaeus, make haste and come down. Raise Lazarus from the dead. Praise the Lord. Went to Peter's mother-in-law's house. Yeah, he did. Let a prostitute wash his feet. Yeah, he did. But with this man, begging the Lord, let me go with you. The Lord looked at the man and said, it would be good for you. Here's our Lord's thinking. It would be good for you, Rocky. It would be good for you if I would take you with me. Oh, Lord. But I'm concerned about your friends. Oh, I'm concerned about your family. I'm concerned about the Decapolis. There's 10 cities filled with Gentiles who don't know my name. And if I go to them, they won't see me right. They'll see me as a Jew trying to tell the Gentiles what to do. But if you go to them and tell them, look at me, look at the great things that the Lord have done for me. Yeah, I feel my help coming up in here. You ought to grab somebody by the hand and tell, look at me. Look at the great things that the Lord has done for me. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I want to hear some natives praise the Lord. I want to hear some natives praise the Lord. Do I have anybody here? If I name your situation, would you just shout amen or shout glory? Is there anybody here who can say he brought me out? Is there anybody here who can say he lifted me? Is there anybody here who can say I was down for the count, but the Lord lifted me? Do I have anybody here who can say the Lord has done great things? The devil had me bound, but oh, the Lord, oh, the Lord, oh, the Lord, he's done great things in my life. Let me hear you praise the Lord. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I gotta stop this thing. Folk, you ought to worship him like white folk do. Black folk, worship him like black folk do. Latinos, worship him like Latinos do. Let your native worship go up before the Lord. Africans, worship him like Africans do. Hey! Hey! I feel my help here. Oh, yeah! Go home! Go home! Go home! Go home! Go to your friends! Go to your family! Go home! Fire! Come get me, Robert. Woo! Look at this. I said our text will show you how to respond when you get the answer that you didn't seek. Good to see you, DJ. I told you the text would tell you, praise the Lord, how to act when God don't give you what you want. I just showed you. I told you the text would give us Jesus giving a man an answer that he'd never given anybody. He'd never told anyone, no, you can't follow me. The only time that is recorded in scripture is here. He tells this man, you can't go. Somebody says, what about the 10 lepers? They didn't ask to follow him. The way he healed them, he said, go show yourself to the priest. And one came back. He asked them, where's the rest of them? The other should have came back. But with this man, am I right, baby? This man, he said, go. How do you respond when life, when God don't give you the answer that you were seeking? The Bible said, verse 20, and he departed. He obeyed. I want to show you something. I'm getting ready to pray. He departed. Woo! And went throughout the 10 cities, publishing how great things Jesus had done for him. And look at this. This is amazing. Krista, you won't talk about some good preaching. You love good preaching. Show you some good preaching. This guy preached so good that Matthew 8 and I got to come down and show you this. Matthew 8 and 34 reveals something. That when Jesus cast the devil out, told them demons to go, it's the same story. The Bible says, and behold, notice this. Matthew tells us that the whole city came out to meet Jesus. And when they saw him, they besought him that he would depart from their coast. But our text tells us. See, I just wanted you to see Matthew, whole city. Everybody wanted him to leave, whole city. But after the monster man who was delivered, after he got delivered, and he went and preached back to these same McNeil, same people. Somebody says same. See, now, but here's the difference. Even though Jesus is Lord, Jesus was a Jew. Them Gadareans were Gentiles. Jesus sent a Gentile baby. Like them, but different. I can speak your language. I know your customs, but I'm different. And let me tell you what the difference is. I'm washed in the blood. I'm one of you, but I'm not one of you. Same origin, same side of town, but I'm different. See, this thing now where saints are trying to win sinners, being like sinners, won't work. You got to go into the sinners and show the sinners that, yes, we're the same, but I'm different. I'm different. What's different is what the Lord did for me. I'm the guy. I can see him now going into a city in the Decapolis. Say, I know y'all heard about this guy who used to cry and cut himself. You see these scars? That was me. But now he's all intellectual. All calm. Got clothes on. Well dressed. Articulate. And filled with the Holy Ghost. The Bible says when he preached to them people, notice what the text says. It closed with this. It didn't say that they sent him away. It said, different reception now. It says, and they were all amazed. They all marveled. You know what happened? People got saved. We owe the world. We owe our co-workers. We owe the abortion clinics. We owe the homosexuals and lesbians. We owe people. We owe them to go out there, hallelujah, and let them see the difference that Christ has made in our lives. Praise the Lord. We owe the Black Lives Movement, the Black Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter, All Lives Matter movement. We owe them to show them that there's a better way, and that better way is the way of the cross.
It's amazing what Jesus Christ can do for a man or woman who will submit to his love and allow Jesus Christ to come in. Well, we're out of time for today. I pray that you were blessed by the word of the Lord. I want to invite you to join me here at the Upper Room Church of God in Christ in the sanctuary. The only thing that's missing is you. I want you to keep God first, and we look forward to seeing you.